All right, hello and welcome to another Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golden from Sales Pop Online, Sales Magazine and Pipeliner CRM, joining you from beautiful Blue Sky San Diego as usual. And today I'm delighted to be joined by Chawla Dinkoy, who's up in Toronto, Canada. Blue skies there too, yeah?
Yes, hot skies.
Oh, excellent. And Chawla is the CEO and founder of the Repositioning Expert. And she really helps companies with their messaging and particularly with their elevator pitches. So we're going to talk about elevator pitches that wow today. So let's face it, Chawla. I mean, elevator pitches have always been important. But if you think about the circumstances we're in today, it's where your people are distracted, they feel like they're overwhelmed, they feel like they're busier than they've ever been, although I always say they're more distracted rather than more busy. And now they're a little more stressed because maybe their business is hurting from what's going on with the pandemic and all of that. So more than ever, you're only going to get a short window to get somebody to pay attention to you. So your elevator pitch is more important than ever almost.
Yeah, you know, recently I had the wonderful experience of being paid by a giant consumer packaged goods company to be an elevator pitch critique, like to actually give feedback on 10 vendors to pitch to them. And this was in service to the vendors and through Zoom. So it was very, very, very interesting being a fly on the wall of pitches and then seeing the buyer's reactions. And literally, I saw exactly what landed and what didn't. And I know because 18 years, I kept saying no to everyone that was trying to sell to me when I worked at Pepsi, because, that was a sexy brand. And as I told you, I worked for, other sexy brands and everybody always wanted, our marketing dollars. And I always was on the other side saying no. So now I know it. Everything I ever teach was confirmed in those rooms, and it was bloody. It was not pretty. And so the secret is to start immediately talking about them. Yeah. Don't waste the 7 seconds that you have their attention. Just start right talking. And one woman, she didn't speak English, John. She couldn't. These are all from international markets.
Sure.
And God bless her. Like, she was speaking, but I didn't understand a word. And like, kind of like you.
Yeah. Well, being Irish, English is barely our first language.
I'm kidding. No offense. But anyway, so, and yet she had the best pitch. And you know why? She started her screen and I had trained them, right? And some ignored me. And this woman did not. She understood what I was saying. She started the screen. She said, I'm going to share my screen. She started it with their product on their country's Amazon site listing. And then she showed another product that they worked on that was similar, not in the same category, but sure. It was like, one was diapers and the other one was motor oil. And then she showed how she helped on the same site, that same product, by doing all this marketing and how much increase it had on the same page, on the same type of, in the same country. And anyway, it was so powerful. And you can't believe how many buyers were asking questions. Yeah. And I, she didn't even speak English. So that's the lesson, you guys.
Relatable. I mean, if it's not immediately, it doesn't resonate or immediately relatable to me, if it doesn't hit me, if I don't care immediately, if I don't like prick up my ears and go, okay, you've lost me.
Exactly. I mean, why talk about yourself? Stop talking about yourself, guys. I really don't care how many offices you have, how many years you've been in business. I mean, this is coming off as a rant. It's been a long Friday. I don't know.
Yeah, that's fine. No, it's good. It's good. So, what are some of the other mistakes that people are continuing to make, and how should they be modifying things, particularly now, to make sure that they're cutting through all the noise and the stress and the distraction?
All the more important now, they have to stop being generalists. Honest to God, you have to become a specialist. And then what I do for my clients is we find them a super niche. So for example, just a generic IT company, we super niche them into reducing call wait times for healthcare call centers. And we sub-branded a super niche division called On Hold Rescue. and they sold $805,000 in the first quarter just from the super niche. And then they cross-sold other products and services. So super niching is the way.
I love that idea about super niching because, and you don't, and as you said, I mean, to super niche, I mean, what they were solving there, it's still a fairly general issue that they're solving. They're just focusing it on a particular industry. So it's not like you have to become an absolute expert in that niche industry, right? You just have to know enough about it to, and then package and brand it that way.
That's exactly what, I mean, they're an IT company. They can write software for anything. When they meet new clients, that's what they do anyway. But they weren't positioning themselves as anything. They were just calling themselves a generic, we'll do, we'll customize, we'll work with you. Everybody says that, of course they will. But to do the market research that we did, to bucket the industries, and then to ask about their pain points and what we could do this to solve their pain points and how much people would pay for us. That's all research. I learned all that stuff from the Pepsis and the Pizza Huts and the Frito-Lays. And then I'm teaching them how to do them without spending those thousands of research dollars for the small guys like us. But most of the time, you probably have met so many businesses are throwing spaghetti at the wall, trying to figure it out on their own.
No, absolutely. And I think one of the things is that why people talk about themselves a lot is because they know about themselves and they feel comfortable talking about themselves. But they don't.
Excuse.
No, I know it's not. But I'm just saying is, but they don't know enough about the business of business or the business of the people they're talking to. So they avoid that, you know, so they stick with what's comfortable.
Honestly, I agree with you. I think, like I say this in my social media, you know, prompts for driving to my big bootcamp that we're going to talk about, the elevator pitch bootcamp. Whenever you ask even a CEO of a big company about, excuse me, what do you do? And what they say, they go into this trance of what they always say. And it's just coming out of their mouth. They don't even know what they're saying because it's just always what they've said. And then they come to the elevator pitch bootcamp, or they attend one of my sessions and we fix it. Even clients who pay me thousands of dollars and we fix it, I swear to you, John, so many of them don't use it because it's not comfortable.
So talk to me a little bit about how you help people get out of that comfort zone and start to do things differently in the way that you advise them to.
Well, I have no gun to their heads. I mean, I live in Canada. We don't have guns anyway, but I don't have any guns, period, to put to anyone's head. So what happens is my methodology is to teach them how to find out from the market who their niche should be, what the pain point is, and what they should specialize in. I'm not one of these marketers that sits behind my computer and says, oh, I see statistically here that this market is growing and I think you should. No, it's all about, I teach them how to go out and find. And most of that, those conversations actually turn into leads for them. And I teach them how to close those leads. But proof is in the pudding. When they're the horse's mouth, they're talking to the horse's mouth and they're the ones who are finding out and witnessing what is demanded in the market. I pretty much don't have to convince them of anything unless they have some really serious issues around change, then that's a whole different, that's a VIP program there, John.
Right. Absolutely. There's, I mean, change is one of the hardest things. So talk me through, I mean, this bootcamp you do, just out of interest, talk me through the different phases of it and kind of what you cover, because I think that'd be fascinating for people.
It's like, it's going to be like nothing I've ever done before. It is 9 days, John. Every day, it's going to be like Survivor. I'm going to be there. It's going to be like day one, day two. So day it's really 5 days of training, but it's only 45 minutes every night at 8 o'clock in Eastern.
Right.
And so, you know, day one is targeting. Like, how on earth do you pick your target without, you know, throwing a dart and, you know, strategically and intelligently and in a way that's going to give value. And then the second part is, well, how do you figure out your sweet spot niche? And then the third part is, well, let's put it together into the actual formula of the elevator pitch. And then the fourth day is your messaging around the pitch. And then the fifth day is, how do you pitch like a celebrity so that nobody ever cancels on you? Like, nobody cancels on, you know, like Russell Brunson or Oprah, or nobody cancels a meeting with those guys. They'll take a meeting. So those are some of the things. And then we'll do a bonus with actual live, being able to fix people on the spot. I have a podcast called Polish My Pitch. It's 5 minutes, kind of a little bit longer than yours, like maybe a minute longer than yours. And then, you know, they come on the show, I fix them, and then we do a deep dive for 20 minutes on their business. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what's happening in the bootcamp.
So so when you say like a pitch like a celebrity, so nobody ever cancels on you, right? And can you elaborate a little more on that? Because there's probably a lot of people saying, yeah, but you know, I'm a sales guy and I get canceled more than I ever get appointments.
You know what it is? It's visibility in front of them. So, and what I mean by visibility now in this world, like the online world, it's online visibility. So, and I'll give you an example. And if it's a sales rep, there are different ways. I've worked with companies that have reps. I've worked with CEOs. It's mostly the CEO visibility. And by visibility, so part of this bootcamp, I've been interviewing, no kidding, I don't know how many people you interview, but I've been doing like 4 a day, 10 minutes each, and we're streaming it right into the private Facebook group for the CEOs. And people are now starting to call me to get on those interviews. And then when I talk to prospects in the group, they tell me, I've been watching your face all day. That's what celebritizing yourself is. And then once you're familiar to them, once they get to know you, I mean, so many of them said, I feel like I already know you. Because I mean, you know, it doesn't matter the channel. So if you're shy to put your face on, like, you know, you're not shy, obviously, but these things, like doing a podcast.
I'm an introverted extrovert, I say.
Oh, is there such a thing?
Of course.
Is that like a hermaphrodite? I don't know. How does it work? I'm not sure. But anyway, so that's how you do it. You do things like what you're doing. You do things that are targeted to their industry so that constantly, like, they see you, they open the journal for their industry association and they see you quoted, and then they go to their LinkedIn and they see, you know, all of your stuff in LinkedIn. They see your lives in LinkedIn.
Yeah. And I think it's an interesting thing, because before there was a lot of people who are comfortable doing that in person. Like, you know, they'll go to events and networking events and bring it out there. But then you put them into an online world and they like freeze, and then they're, you know, they don't like the way they look. They don't like the way they sound. They don't like this. And that's the kind of thing that you have to help people kind of get over. Because as you say, you know, you're in a dogfight for eyeballs.
Yes. And I think with the economy right now, it's a shrinking spend pool. Mm-hmm. And to your point, it is like very competitive, like dogfight. For one of my webinars, I say, have you Googled free training coronavirus? And then there's like 4 million hits because everybody's doing something for free or cheaper. So now, like, it is, and your true value is in being different. And being visible with that difference. And the difference has to be about their pain. Like, you just have to own one facet of the diamond. And if you can own it and put that out there in front of them every day, all day, then you're gold.
Yeah. And the interesting thing, and I think this is one of the problems that often, you know, companies face, is that they do this exercise. Maybe they did it 2 years ago, or maybe they did it last year, and they say, okay, we're good. We've got our messaging down. And, but the problem is that, you know, customers are dynamic. The world is dynamic, as we see.
Yes.
A little bit more dynamic than we like it to be, perhaps, but it is. And it's funny, I was talking to the CEO of a marketing agency this morning, and he actually said that a lot of the companies he was working with, their messaging is shifting a little bit now towards cost savings and risk mitigation and all of that, because that's where their customers' heads are at now.
Well, listen, you know, you've heard of the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, a theory that I love from one of the coaches that I've had is that there's this COVID, you know, pyramid where businesses at the bottom are just, you know, like they were in survival. And then now they're in recovery, and the next one is going to be growth, and the next one is going to be like vision, like future. Mm-hmm. But right now, if you're selling a service or you're using language to the top of the pyramid, you've lost them. You're like tone deaf. So that's why it makes so much sense to talk about the bottom of the pyramid, which is survival and recovery. So good for him.
Yeah, but I think the interesting thing, though, is that to your point, is that, you know, you have to continuously look at your message. You're going to continuously look at your market and make sure that, you know, you're not getting comfortable with just having a, you know, doing your boot camp once and then good, sorted, got my elevator pitch. Don't have to worry about this for the next 5 years.
I mean, right now, so many of my clients are pivoting the industries that they focus on and pivoting the services that they deliver. And the more nimble ones are already there. They're already seeing the results, but it's the slower ones that have been resisting and just like, let's wait and see. Those are the ones that are just now starting to pivot, and everyone's going to have to change to survive either way.
Yeah. And I think also, I mean, you'll probably find this as well. I mean, to your point, as you started at the beginning, is that you need your message to immediately be focused on them, immediately be focused on what's important to them. And I think, today you have to have even a greater level of some level of humanization of it as well, because I think people, yes, yeah, because we've hidden behind technology for a long time, trying to dehumanize everything. And now people are, you know, maybe stuck at home for the first time ever, and the world has changed and they're feeling a little more, you know, vulnerable, that humanizing things is a good way to go.
And this is the way to do it right now, because how else? Like all my conferences were canceled. I'm not even allowed in the US because, you know, the borders are closed. And, you know, I spoke at 14 conferences last year in the US. How am I going to do that this year? I can't. So when I do a live presentation like the boot camp and I'm in your living room every night for 9 days, you probably haven't seen your mother that often.
Yeah. No, I think that's a point that people need to realize, is because a lot of the times you have people right now who are just, you know, harking, you know, just saying, okay, everything's going to get back to normal. When everything gets back to normal, I can't wait. Instead of going, well, number one, things may not get back to what you consider normal. And the second thing is, you can't wait. You can't wait, and you have to adapt to. So if things are done online now, you just have to embrace it, adapt it, and do the best you can, because you don't know how long. And this may be forever. Who knows? I don't mean the virus, but I mean, this may be your forever way of doing business going forward, because it may be a better way to do it.
God willing, I'd love it not to get onto a plane again, except when I want to. I'd love it.
Yeah. Before we finish up, do you want to just give another quick overview of your boot camp and how people can find out more about it? It'll be in your contributor bio anyway, but
it's at repositioner.com, which is my website, /bootcamp.
Yeah. So I would really encourage people, like I said, is even at the best of times, it's hard to get people's attention, because everybody will tell you they're so much more, or so much busier than they've ever been. You know, I'm so overwhelmed, so much busier. And like I said, the reality is you're so much more distracted than you've ever been.
I like
but,
that.
But regardless, it's hard to get people's attention. And then when you layer in the level of stress and uncertainty and stuff that there is now, it's almost impossible to get their attention if you don't do what Chawla is talking about here. So I would definitely encourage you to check out the boot camp and to really revisit your messaging. I mean, don't assume that you can just stick with what you have and eventually this will all pass and everything will be fine.
Thank you, John. That was a really nice endorsement.
Absolutely. Listen, my name is John Golden, Sales Pop Online, Sales Magazine, Pipeliner, CRN. Chawla, thank you very much for joining us today, and I'll see you all for another expert interview really soon. Thank you.
Thank you.